I've set all these metronomes to vivace, which is 152 beats per minute. So although the frequencies are all the same, I'm going to start the metronomes at random times, so they'll initially not be in phase with one another. But because these oscillators are all coupled together through the platform, the system will naturally evolve towards a low energy state. In this particular system, the lowest energy state is when the metronomes are all in phase with one another. All of the metronomes ended up in phase with each other because the coupling strings between them were all the same. But imagine if we could program the coupling strings between each oscillator independently. In such a situation, some of the oscillators would end up in phase with one another, but then some of them could also end up out of phase with one another. There are only two possible binary outcomes. We could call the in-phase case 1, and we could call the out-of-phase case 0. Imagine that we had a system of thousands of such coupled oscillators, and we could control the interactions between them. It turns out that such a system of coupled oscillators forms a highly parallel type of computing architecture known as the Ising model. In this equation, the H stands for the Hamiltonian. And the Hamiltonian of any physical system describes the dynamics of that system. In this situation, if you minimize the Hamiltonian, you minimize the total energy. So what we're looking for in an Ising computer is a natural system that can find the minimum energy state. In the equation that you're seeing, the sigmas describe the spin state. In other words, for each one of these oscillators, it's either going to be spin up, which can be considered 1, or spin down, which in the original Ising model is minus 1. The J describes the connection between the cells. So if you can imagine a system where all of the J's are programmable and then have that system reach its minimum energy state, then the sigmas at the end would either end up as 1 or minus 1. In the case of these oscillators, a 1, for example, could be the in-phase case, and the minus 1 could be the out-of-phase case. Earlier, I called it 0 and 1 because in the case of computers, we usually talk about 1s and 0s as being the binary outcome. Now, if the system is not coupled very well, then we're not going to get this minimum energy state. We're not going to get the synchronization. Let me demonstrate it. Now, for this demonstration, I've set these metronomes here to allegretto, 72 beats per minute. I'm going to kind of hold the table so that the coupling through the table is not very strong. Let's let the system evolve for a little while. I'm holding the table so that the table can't shake. Okay, so as we can see, these metronomes are not synchronizing. The reason why they're not synchronizing is because the coupling between them is weak. I'm holding the table, they can't phase lock. Now, let's go back and think about why the metronomes were able to synchronize in the previous case. The reason why they were able to synchronize is because the metronomes shake the table. This is called injection locking. Let me demonstrate now myself as the injection locking mechanism. Injection locking is really something very interesting, and what it means is that I'm going to drive the system at the same frequency that each one of these oscillators is set at, and by driving it externally, I can cause these oscillators to phase lock. Now I'm going to injection lock the system. I'm going to kind of look at this metronome to guide my hands, and I'm going to move the table at the same frequency. So I've injection locked this table, and I've injection locked all the oscillators that are on it. Now I want to demonstrate something else, because in the example that you just saw, I injection locked the metronomes to the same frequency that they're programmed at, this allegretto, or 72 beats per minute. And you notice that the metronomes all ended up in phase with one another. If we were to build an Ising computer and all the oscillators always ended up in phase with one another, it wouldn't give us any interesting information. What we need is for the system to evolve naturally into its binary state but we want to make sure that sometimes the oscillators can end up out of phase with one another. To do that, we need to use something called subharmonic injection locking. To demonstrate subharmonic injection locking, I'm going to turn over here to the piano for just a moment for demonstration. So the piano is an interesting system to demonstrate injection locking because each one of these keys has been tuned to a very specific frequency. For example, the A below middle C has been tuned to 220 hertz. When I press this key, the string is going to be struck with a hammer and then the string will vibrate at 220 beats per second. If I go up one octave to the next A, that is the A above middle C, this string has been tuned to 440 hertz. In other words, twice the frequency as the A below it. And if I play these two A's together, it sounds nice. It's an octave. The reason it sounds nice is because the frequencies are related by a very simple mathematical relationship. For example, this frequency, 440 hertz, it's just twice the frequency of the previous frequency, which was 220 hertz. Now I want to demonstrate something about the way the dampers work on the piano. If you look inside the piano, you see a sequence of felt dampers, and they prevent the strings from vibrating. This pedal on the right causes the dampers to lift off of the strings, as you can see here. When I release the pedal, the dampers are reapplied to the string. Let me play a few keys together while the damper is raised. Now let me release the damper. All right, so you can see what the damper does. Now if I just strike one key, the piano has a mechanism so that the damper is released from the string temporarily, and then it settles back down onto the string a moment later. Right, so we can only hear the sound while the key is being struck. If I leave the key pressed down, then the damper is lifted off of the string, but I haven't pressed it hard enough to actually hear anything. But this string now, the string that's set to 220 hertz, could vibrate if it were struck with a hammer. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to strike the key whose string is tuned to 440 hertz. We can still hear a tone at 440 hertz, even though this string is completely damped. The reason is because the string that's normally tuned to 220 hertz is now vibrating. Let me do it again. You hear how that tone is ringing? That's this string that's vibrating, not that string. This is called subharmonic injection locking. I've applied a signal at twice the frequency and I've caused that string to vibrate even though I've not touched that string. Let me demonstrate that this only works with the A. If I hit an E flat, you're not going to hear the E flat ring out. Yeah, we don't hear it, right? We don't hear it. So now I want to demonstrate this subharmonic injection locking with these two metronomes here. In order to do that, I'm going to have to use my hands to shake the table at exactly double the frequency that these metronomes are set to. It's hard for me to internally be able to come up with this frequency. So in order to do that, I've got a reference metronome over here, and I've programmed this something like allegro. It's around 140 something beats per minute. In other words, this metronome is set at twice the frequency here. Now, there's not going to be any coupling between this metronome and these two because this is a really solid table. But I can use this metronome as a visual aid to myself, and I'll shake the table when I see the pendulum swing over here. Now, what I hope to achieve here is a demonstration that these two metronomes can end up in the out-of-phase case when I use the subharmonic injection locking. So again, I'm going to start these off randomly, and I'm going to try to shake the table in sync with this metronome that's going faster over here. Okay, so we've ended up in the in-phase case, right? These were just now together. Maybe if I start them a little bit closer to the out-of-phase case, we could end up with that. Okay, I almost ended up in the out-of-phase case. the point that I'm trying to make here is that with subharmonic injection locking, they won't always end up in phase. So if we're going to build an Ising computer, for example, with some other physical system, it's necessary to have some way to nudge a system towards such final energy state. So this concept of injection locking is really interesting because it applies not only to mechanical systems like these metronomes we have here, but any system that can oscillate. If you drive a system of oscillators externally with some kind of a force that's near the frequency that the oscillators work at or at a harmonic of it, then you can cause these oscillators to all end up in phase or out of phase with one another. For example, if you have a system of lasers, lasers that are independent will not quite have the same wavelength. They won't have the same frequency as one another, and they certainly won't be in phase with each other. But if you have a master laser, an external laser that has almost the same wavelength as all of the lasers that you want to injection lock, then it's possible to shine that master laser light into all of the lasers that you plan to injection lock and force them to all be at the same wavelength and all in phase with one another. So that's a very useful concept with lasers. And injection locking generally can be very useful to cause systems of oscillators to synchronize. In the case of an Ising computer, you need to have some way to nudge the system into the low energy state. And this subharmonic injection locking is one way to do it.